It's time for Windows Weekly. Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley are here. Microsoft's answer to the Echo. Hello. Coming up, we know a little bit more. We also know a lot more about the Windows Cloud platform that Microsoft's planning to announce next week. And how is the Creators Update 2 weeks in? It's all coming up next on Windows Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Windows Weekly is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Windows Weekly with Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley, episode 515, recorded Wednesday, April 26th, 2017. You will be degraded. Windows Weekly is brought to you by Upside, the smart new way to save big money on business travel. Visit Upside.com and enter the code Windows to be guaranteed at least a $100 gift card when you book your first trip. And by WordPress. WordPress powers 27% of all websites, including mine. Get 15% off your new website at WordPress.com/Windows. That's WordPress.com/Windows. And by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/windows. It's time for Windows Weekly, the show where we cover the latest news from Microsoft. Of course, we couldn't do that if we didn't have Mary Jo Foley here. She writes the All About Microsoft blog for ZDNet. Great to see you and your new digs. We'll talk about that in a sec. Mm-hmm. Paul Thurrott also here. Couldn't do it without him either, from Thurrott.com. Together they represent the pinnacle, the zenith, the apogee.
And not the lollipop twins or whatever.
of technology journalism. And we're here for episode 515. Mm-hmm. So you moved. You moved, Mary Jo.
I did. I moved.
And you like the new place?
And yeah, I really like the new place. It's so much more roomy. Oh. I mean, it's not really square footage-wise, but now I have rooms.
Did your 70-inch TV arrive yet?
I have my TV. I even watched TV one night already.
What?
I know.
It's begun.
It's begun.
Yep. And did you enjoy watching TV? Paul and I are going,
whoa. I mean.
No, you know what? I was so tired.
What was TV like to the Amish?
Exactly. I was so tired. I sat down, I turned the TV on, and I'm like, I don't even know what I'm watching, but I just need to like sit here for a minute and do nothing.
You really got that. You got the whole thing right away. That's excellent.
I did.
Good job. Yeah.
At one point, did the thought go through your mind? So this is what it's like to be Paul every single day.
Aw, come on.
Every single day. Next, you know, she'll be playing Fallout 4 and going to doing cosplay. You know,
let's not go that far.
If it works out that like she's sniping me from some hidden spot in Call of Duty, I'm going to consider this a net loss. But
till then, yeah. Hey, that's great. And how was the move? Was it easy?
It was pretty good. I only moved like 3 blocks from where I lived. So, but you know, when you move, you still have to pack everything. It doesn't matter if it's 3 blocks or 3,000 miles on the way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You didn't just carry it over one at a time. Like here's a drawer full of silverware.
I did carry over my plants by hand and food, but that's it.
Wow.
Yeah.
And so
are
you closer to Rattlinghum? Is that the point?
No, I'm a little further away, but not way much. Further. I'm closer to Grand Central Station and closer to the Chrysler Building now.
So it's like north of where you were?
A little north of where I was before. Yep.
Paul, don't pretend you know Manhattan.
He kind of knows.
I there's a like a 1 square mile part of Manhattan that I am intimately familiar with, Leo. It's the between Penn Station and Rattlinghum.
Post office. Yeah, that's right. Back and forth.
Yep.
Well, Amazon announced two huge new products.
No.
Did they really?
Yeah. No. Has nothing to do with Amazon.
One of them was an April Fool's joke, apparently. Yeah. And the other one was,
did you
what
see,
was the other
though, actually, there is a product. The new Amazon Echo is designed for fashion mavens. It sits in your closet, yeah, and you say, take a picture of me. And you can have a still or a video of you twirling in your outfit. And then it...
You know, my initial reaction to this product is incredibly negative. But I think... it almost suggests to me that the market for this device is over, because now they're going after some bizarre niche market.
Yeah, yeah.
And no. I just don't understand.
I think this is a cover.
Really?
I do. I think this is like they introduced some weird niche thing for this new device, but I think it's going to be more than that. I think it's going to be like a security camera for your home.
Well, or lots of things, right? I mean, there's lots of things it could be.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, I think just the fashionista thing is just like, oh, we have this thing. Like, look at this. Let's see how it goes. And then, you know, they'll get it into some retail stores and people will see, oh, there's some business potential for this thing. Next thing you know, home automation, then other things. It'll be bigger than it looks, I think.
It will have to be.
Yeah.
I know. It's not just for fashion. Although I did immediately put in my ask for an invitation because I like to know if my outfit is somebody tweeted or put on Facebook. Yeah, great. So you tell me if the three shirts I'm wearing go with the jeans I've worn for the last 3 years.
Yeah.
You know, most guys won't find value in this, I don't think.
Lexi could just be like, I'm not saying it looks bad, but I just threw up in my mouth.
Yeah. No, I agree with you, Mary Jo. There's got to be more than meets the eye here. First of all, it costs more than a regular Echo. Reason I bring it up is we're finally seeing some information about Microsoft's answer to the Echo, which Microsoft's not making. Harman Kardon is, right?
That's right.
Bring Cortana home. She promises not to comment on your fashion.
Right. Actually, not a bad selling point.
Yeah.
It is. I know. That would be a plus. We knew as of last December that Harman Kardon was building a Cortana-powered speaker. We knew that because Microsoft teased it then.
Was that from WinHeck? Was that the timing of that?
Yeah, it was right around that time, around WinHeck China, because that's the same time they released this Cortana devices SDK for OEMs to build these kinds of things.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. But then we've heard nothing basically since.
Sure.
The ones who've been reporting on this though are MS Power User. They've been doing some really good stuff. They found out the name of the speaker is going to be Invoke.
Invoke. Oh, I like that. I think that's okay.
Do you? Yeah, you like that?
Yeah, because you're invoking it.
Right.
I thought we knew the name Invoke before, no?
I think they found the name originally.
Oh, okay. Oh, I got you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And then just... A few hours ago, they reported that they have seen the interface for controlling it in Cortana on Android somehow, and that you will be able to control not just Groove music streaming, but also Spotify, Pandora, and a number of other music services.
Good. That's critical, I think.
That's good. But the question is, like, where is this thing? And who's going to test it? And when are we going to see it? All these questions, right?
Will it be, do we know if it will be voice invocable? Will you just say, hey, you know who?
Or it has to be, right?
Hey, see.
Yeah, for sure. For sure it will. Yep.
Well, I don't know if it has to be, but it's, I mean, it's certainly, I would want it to be. But remember, Amazon sold a version of the Echo, the tap that you had to touch, which, by the way, they then amended to make it so you didn't have to touch it. So maybe that was how they learned that was not a good idea.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, just by not releasing anything, you can learn from all the mistakes of your competitors, I guess.
Right. Well, I mean, that's the defense. When you say, well, Microsoft, you're 2 years late to the game, you're even after Google, but that's the defense is, yeah, but look, we can kind of see what worked and didn't work.
I don't know. Every passing day, this seems late to me. And I spoke to them back in January, and they seem to have a master plan. They seem to be unconcerned. In sort of a superficial level, I appreciate the notion that this market hasn't really gelled yet, and they feel like that if they come in with something really high quality and necessary, that it could be successful, but I'm sure that's exactly what they said about the iPhone. You know, I really feel like they have to have something.
Yeah.
You know,
the interesting thing was at WinHack China, they said, if you're using Cortana this way, you have to have a screen.
Right. I remember that. That was weird.
If it's on Windows 10 IoT, like right. Anything that's got Windows 10 IoT inside has to have a screen to use Cortana voice in this kind of a fashion.
Makes no sense.
We found out later, this is powered by Linux. The Harman Kardon speaker is powered by Linux. It's not powered by Windows.
That's embarrassing.
Well,
you know, in a way, it kind of doesn't matter,
no,
right?
Of course, I mean, it doesn't. No, it doesn't matter. But what does matter is that screen requirement on Windows IoT. The point of IoT is that it can be headless. Well, not the point. One of the points of it, you know, is that it can be headless.
Yeah, you don't want screens in a lot of them. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
That's very common.
But that's a definite requirement. It's not something Microsoft has amended. I don't think they're going to change it. If you want to develop a speaker and you're an OEM and you don't want to have a screen, you can't use Windows 10 inside. So that's interesting. I wonder about build now, because the next big thing that's coming up where it maybe they could talk about this and show it is build. Maybe they could even give them out to people at build as a giveaway to test them for them.
Sure.
But we don't know that. MS Power user said they heard Microsoft's going to talk about the speaker at build, but they didn't say they're going to give them out. The piece that's missing here, which is really weird, is the thing that's called Cortana Skills Kit. Cortana Skills Kit is like the skills kit. It's the thing that as a software developer you need to build skills for Cortana. Microsoft said earlier this year, this public preview of the skills kit would be out February 27th. Like they said a date, like here's the date, February 27th.
Very specific.
February 27th has come and gone. We're now like almost at April 27th, right? And it's nowhere in sight, which makes me think they're holding this announcement now till build. So that kind of gives more credence to the idea that maybe we will hear more about Invoke at build if they talk about the Cortana skills kit there.
They're going to have to invoke an exorcist for this thing to be successful at build. I don't know. I just don't understand. I think I have to send a sentence there. I don't understand.
Just leave it there. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. It makes a lot of sense for them to talk about this at build in a way, because last year at build, they talked about bots and bot framework, and you can use Cortana Skills Kit to build bots and use bots in conjunction with the speaker. But it's kind of weird that they set this date, February 27th, and then the date came, went, and nobody said anything. I ask every couple weeks, like, hey, how about that skills kit? Nope. Yep.
What was the significance of that date, if any?
I don't know. I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not sure why they picked that date. They made it a public announcement, and I forget what they had. They had some event where they said it's going to be on February 27th. Odd. Yeah. And you know, the cool thing about the skills kit, if it operates the way they originally described it, is you could take skills if you had developed them as a programmer and port them more easily over to Cortana if you wanted to support that platform too. So that would be good. I mean, Amazon has something like what's the number they have now? I'm looking for it in my I wrote something like 10,000 skills right now. So Microsoft has a lot of catching up to do on this.
Did they say 2017 as part of that February date, or do we know that
they
it was?
They did. Okay. Yeah, it was that. Yep. So yeah, I think we're going to hear about this at build. That's my new prediction based on kind of how things are coming together.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah.
It just seems odd they haven't issued a statement to some, although it also may be telling that they didn't, because it suggests they're not getting a lot of pushback on it.
Yeah.
Meaning interest, you know.
Right. Amazon first opened up Alexa to developers a year and a half ago. There are now more than 10,000 skills for Alexa.
Right.
So, yeah.
Look at the date on that, because I think it's even a higher number now. I think it's
I'm sure it's higher. That was a few months ago.
Yeah.
So.
She's going to help you get dressed now. I mean,
yeah, she's skilled.
Yeah.
Actually, there are like 30 new commands associated with the new fashion. Racco, I should say.
Brittana can tell you the weather, and then she can crack some jokes. So, you know, we got that.
I wonder if that's part of it, is that they're rapidly adding capabilities before release.
Actually, well, to be fair to Microsoft, and God, it's hard sometimes, they have done a big push around reminders in Cortana. And it's one of those things they've kind of released little updates from time to time. And that does fall into the little strategy about being so useful that you become necessary. In other words, that if you start using this thing and it goes away, you would really miss it. And we used an Alexa for an Echo for a couple of weeks and didn't find it to be essential. I bought a Google Home and then ended up returning it before I even opened it because at the time it didn't support multiple accounts. And the way that they did shopping lists was kind of weird. They used, I don't know if they used Keep yet or whatever it was at the time, but they've actually fixed both those things. So Google Home becomes a lot more interesting because it works in a more, you know, kind of a more essential fashion. Microsoft needs to put something out. I mean, I get the point of being necessary and all that stuff, but you can't wait until it's complete. You know, these things you're competing with by nature are incomplete. That's the point of the skill sets and so forth. So hopefully this happens quick.
Yeah. You know, speaking of reminders, the other day on my Android phone, I suddenly started getting reminders from Cortana.
Yep.
Like for the first time, they just started popping up. And it was based on emails that I had written, like where I had made some casual time reference in the email. But I didn't even know I had that turned on. And it popped up and I was like, oh.
So actually, you use a Microsoft type email account. Is that right?
Right.
I looked at our office. That's why you're seeing that. So that's the type of thing I think they're going to be adding to Gmail accounts later in the year. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that if you're using Office 365 or Outlook.com, you will start seeing that stuff. And it's funny how these things kind of pop down the mobile now because, you know, a month ago or whenever it was, Cortana out of the blue just started putting up a little weather forecast every morning. You probably saw this, right? You get up in the morning and it's like, hey, it's going to be, you know, 58 degrees and sunny or whatever. Mm-hmm. So that's a feature that, you know, when I mentioned the reminders they've been, you know, working on
kind
all
filtering
year.
Filtering in, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's one of those features, right? It's automatic. Mm-hmm. You know, you make a casual, I'll be sure to get back to you on that. And then it prompts you and says, hey, you said you were going to get back to them on that. Do you want to set up a reminder? You know, it's useful. It's useful.
Yeah, I didn't like it. I shut it off. You know what? Because
it is also
annoying. I think I make a lot of casual time references and things that I don't actually consider to be commitments. So some of them, they were asking me, I didn't want to be called on it. Right. And so it was like, did you want to tell Paul this by such and such a time?
You put Paul off 17 times. Can I just make the reminder?
And then the other confusing thing that's been happening too, is sometimes on my Android phone, Google starts giving me reminders.
Yeah.
Through cards. And I'm like, wait, now how come it only does this sometimes? And very arbitrarily.
That's actually the problem with all of this stuff. In fact, this is the problem with notifications in general. Actually, you've highlighted two of the problems. One is that they're annoying, which they are. And two is that they're unreliable.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the problem. That's, by the way, the dark side of Microsoft's little vision. What happens when you do start to rely on this functionality and it only works occasionally, you know, 78% of the time or whatever. Mm-hmm. That in many ways can be more annoying than it just not being there.
Right. Right. So, yeah, I kind of am intrigued by the idea of some of these things that the personal assistants can do for you, but I'm also just so not used to it. It's hard when you've done things a certain way for so long and then suddenly there are things popping up telling you to do things and you're like, wait, do I even want this? Like, I don't plan that way and I don't think that way and I don't...
Sure.
I still write down a lot of reminders on yellow notes, sticky notes. Like physical ones, not the ones on Windows 10. Like the real pieces of paper.
That was how I understood it, as you said it, yes.
You know, like, I'm like, when I said it, then I'm like, no. Like these things.
I think that actually most people use their voice assistants, whichever ones they are, for really like, I bet you if the research came back, like three different things most of the time. Mm-hmm. And whatever that thing is that got you. Reminders is a big one, though, I have to say.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Because it has a timer on it, you know, I mean, it.
And you're often in a situation where it just makes sense to do it that way.
Yeah.
It could be something as simple as you're out walking around and you're listening to some podcast. Oh, I got to remember to do this thing. It's so nice to be able to just say it and not sit there in the sun and try to type it. Or maybe you're driving in a car or hopefully not in a crowded train or whatever. But in many situations, you know, just being able to do that is neat. And then the thing that Mary Jo just described where it does it based on emails automatically is also very cool. And or annoying, you know, depending on your bent, I guess.
When is build?
Build is 2 weeks.
So we'll learn then.
Yep.
Something.
2 weeks
I won't
from
be
today.
Here for your build show.
I know.
I'm going out to see my son graduate from college. All
right, that's right. That's amazing.
Celebrate. No more writing checks.
That's why I said it was amazing. Not so much for the life milestone for your son, but rather for the life milestone for you.
Yeah. Huge. Yeah. You'll understand this because...
Oh, no, I understand it
You'll
right
have two
now.
Kids in college at the same time. And boy, there's nothing better, I tell you.
Yeah.
Thank God I saved all this time.
Yeah.
No.
I've been trying to talk Kelly into just becoming like an electrician or something.
Right.
But
college is so overrated. It's so overrated. Yeah. No, I'm not. I'm kidding. I'm joking. Be cool. Stay in school.
Also be self-reliant, maybe.
Yeah, and pay for it yourself. So there.
Yeah.
No, I'm actually really proud and happy. And he's looking this summer for his last internship.
Mm.
So that's kind of.
How would he like to be a Throt.com gopher?
He would. He would. Yeah. I'm actually pinging all the people I know, saying, mm-hmm. "You need anybody? You need an intern?"
Mostly I'm looking for a wingman in Call of Duty. How does he feel about it?
I think he'd be very happy.
Yeah.
Very
basically
happy
8 hours a day
that.
Of video gaming.
The only issue might be Dedham. Can he live in New York
the
and
issue
commute?
Might be Dedham. not from Dedham.
So build is Wednesday the 10th, I think.
Right.
And the truth is I don't really need to be here. I wish I could be there. Mm-hmm. But it's hard from here because you can't, you know, as often the case in these things, you can't hear me. I can't, you know, it's better for you just to do the show. So, seriously, we'll have Megan or somebody, a host here, do the ads.
Yeah.
But you'll be taking the whole show because I'm sure you have lots of guests and all that stuff.
Yeah, so it could be pretty interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't need me. So maybe we'll hear more about this at Build. Now would be the time. Well, but I guess they already have a Cortana API that this would take advantage of, right? They don't need to. Developers don't need to do anything special for this, or do they?
Well,
there's a Cortana skills kit, right?
There are Cortana APIs now that people could use for various things, but it seems like you would want the skills kit just to make it something easier and kind of just be able to churn out these skills.
Amazon really makes quickly. It really easy.
Yeah.
That's the big strength on that side right now. And that's the issue here, isn't it? I mean, if you have an existing service, a music service like Spotify or something, you know, you need this to integrate with Cortana. That's the thing that's needed, isn't it? The skill.
I think. I mean, this. I don't know if the skills kit is needed to integrate it, but it's needed to quickly build the skills.
The way it works with Amazon is really nice because not only do they have a very simple API and you can use the mm-hmm. language of your choice, but they have the servers for it. It's all set up, so you just log into Lumberyard and you create a skill very easily. You can have a personal skill. They even make it possible to have a skill that only you can use, mm-hmm. and it costs mm-hmm. very little if the traffic is light. And then if you want to do more, you can beef it up. I think the fact that they have 10,000 plus skills is a testament to that they're doing mm-hmm. something right.
Yep.
But the skills are developed in many cases, I think, are not for-profit skills.
Right.
They're for other reasons. So Jeopardy has a skill. They're not making any money on it, but it promotes Jeopardy. It's good for Jeopardy.
Brand awareness.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah. So that means, you know, people aren't going to, don't, you know, once you do it for, well, the Echo, doesn't mean you're locked in by any means. You could do it. You'd probably want to do it.
Yeah. For by the way, this goes both ways, right? In other words, if you want to do something like control Sonos with your whatever device, you know, you're probably not going to buy a Sonos because it's supported on the device, but you might buy the device if it supports Sonos. And so from Microsoft's perspective, it makes sense for them to be as open about this stuff as possible, because if someone looks at this thing, the Harman Kardon speaker or any future Cortana device, and they use Spotify, one of the questions they might have is, does this work with Spotify? And if it doesn't, they're just going to move along because the other ones already do.
Right.
You know, or potentially already do.
Right.
Yeah, they can't make it groove only. If it was groove only.
Yeah, they can't make it groove only.
Just like, you know, we were talking like, where does the mobile client work for this Invoke thing? And Paul's like, it's not just Windows 10 mobile, right? I'm like, no, it's also Android. I'm sure it's going to be iOS. It's going to be open.
I almost had a little meltdown there when I saw the picture. I was like, please tell me this isn't Windows 10 mobile.
Well, so there's a skill set for people developing skills, the skills SDK. And then the other side, of course, is the licensing. I mean, again, Echo is way ahead of the game. I mean, it's already in cars and refrigerators and all sorts of stuff. Mm-hmm. But I presume this is something Microsoft could do very well.
Yeah, Microsoft and Google, by virtue of the fact that they have search engines, are uniquely positioned to be able to do this kind of thing. But the issue is Google is doing it. You know, I mean, Microsoft is sort of doing it. They have Cortana as a thing. I mean, it's on PCs, it's on phones and all that. But, you know, you got to get the customers where they are. And that involves, you know, you got to be in a car, which I guess you sort of are if you're on a phone, and you got to be at home.
Yep.
Okay. Let's take a break. Okay. Right? Why not?
Okay.
Oh, Dr. Mom's telling me the new Echo Bee thermostat will have Echo built in. And Echo is also being widely used for home automation, not just Echo Bee, but Nest and...
Interesting.
Works with hubs, and so I mean, you're coming up against an ecosystem that's fairly mature at this point.
I worked out great for mobile. What's the problem?
But well, you know, I wonder, is it like that or not? I don't know.
Because Microsoft's not even playing in home automation yet, right? Like, that's another area you're kind of like, how can they not be in home automation?
Well, but that's the point. I mean, in other words, if the skills aren't available for those home automation things, then you're just locked out of what people are already doing. I don't think... You know, smart home automation is kind of behind the curve a little bit here, right? It's not even where 4K probably is right now, but it's still important, and that stuff is out there. And who owns Nest again? I mean, and what do you think they're integrating with? And it's tough. Yep. You can't just be excluded from everything, because eventually you just don't matter anymore.
Unlike phones, though, with you and me aside, Paul, most people have one phone, but there's no reason to think they might only have one assistant or... I mean,
well, but eventually you do kind of want to whittle it down to one, don't you? I mean, it's confusing to have multiple assistants on a phone. And unfortunately for Microsoft, the native situation is it will always be number two, you know, Cortana, because they have Siri already on iPhone and they have Google Assistant or whatever we're calling it this week on Google. So you're always going to have to wedge yourself in there somehow, and you can do it a little bit on Android, but I believe off the top of my head, I don't think you can still do an Oscar-type invocation on Android unless the app is running on the screen, you know, like you can with the other assistants, and that makes it less usable, frankly.
That was fun. You triggered mine, and I imagine many others at Cortana with that, and I have some...
I live to do that. Xbox off.
Let's take a little break and come back and talk more. How about that? What do you think?
Sounds good.
We have a new advertiser to welcome. And I've been using it, and I really like it. So I want to tell everybody about Upside.com. It is a new travel site specifically for business travel. So if you work at a big company, when we worked at Ziff Davis, you know, they had a travel department. And if you were, you know, doing business travel, you call them and they'd book it all for you. But if you're a small or medium business like ours, like Twit, this can be a challenge. Upside is the best new way for small and medium-sized companies to book business travel. It comes to you from a name you'll know, Jay Walker. He founded Priceline. In fact, when I talked to Jay, I said, was William Shatner your idea? He says, yes, yes, it was. Best idea you ever had. Upside is really cool. It bundles flights and hotels together at one price. Your company will save on business travel, and we've tested it with a bunch of business travel, and it really does save over every other site. It's a lot easier to use as well, but here's something that's super cool about Upside. So your company saves, but also you get gift cards with every trip you book, which means you save even more. Choose gift cards from over 50 top brands, including Amazon and Target and Nordstrom. Here's the deal. This will take you just a couple of minutes. If you go to Upside.com, there's no need to spend time comparing a long list of choices and prices. Upside finds the top six flights and hotels right away. And it's not, you get to choose by the name, the hotel, the airline, the flight time. There's no mystery here. All your frequent flyer miles, of course, you get them. They do have 24/7 concierge level customer service. You can call or email or chat. Or reach them on social before, during, and after every trip so you're not operating in a vacuum. If you're a frequent business traveler, this will save your company a ton of money. And by the way, every time you book a trip, you'll get a gift card worth $100, $200, even $300, which is actually awfully sweet. You get even more with overseas trips. And you'll get your gift card via email within 72 hours after booking. They even have a kind of a gift card hub that you can use, check out. Spend even through. There's no limit on trips, no limit on gift cards either. If you travel on business or you know somebody who does, tell them about Upside. Upside's really awesome. Just give it a try once and I think you'll see. In fact, it's great to do a comparison. That's what I did. And I saved on Upside and I got the gift card. Book your business travel at Upside.com. Get a $100 minimum gift card on your first trip when you use the promo code WINDOWS. On that first booking. Now, there's some incentive, a $100 gift card. Incidentally, if in our case, we're booking business travel and we are the people paying for the business travel, we can apply the gift card to the cost of travel immediately. So you could say, you know, if you don't, you could save even more. It's a really good deal. Save big on travel, get a big gift card every trip, minimum purchase required. See site for complete details. It's easy. It's upside.com. And don't forget, the offer code is WINDOWS for that $100 minimum gift card on your first trip. Upside.com. Paul Thurrott, Mary Jo Foley. We're talking about Microsoft. Big changes to the Windows 10 Office 365 and Office support life cycles. What's going on?
This is going to be a challenge to explain this one.
Okay. All right.
Yes,
then you both can do it. I'll let you both do it.
Okay. I'll take a crack at it.
Yeah, please do.
Okay.
On the day I moved, April 20th, Microsoft made this huge announcement that was kind of buried in a couple of blog posts. So they announced that going forward, starting this September, they are going to be delivering two versions of Windows 10 feature updates and two versions of Office 365 Pro Plus updates per year. Both of them are going to happen in March and September. So one thing that immediately means is Redstone 3 is going to come in September. Redstone 4 is going to come in March next year. But here's where this announcement got kind of tricky and messy.
Oh, there was one place?
Oh, there are a few. So yep. When I say Office 365 Pro Plus, what that is a subscription version of Office. It costs $12 per user per month.
By Office, you mean the client Windows or Mac applications, the rich desktop apps.
Right. What's in Office 365 Pro Plus is Word, Excel, PowerPoint, Outlook, OneDrive for Business, OneNote, Publisher, Skype for Business, and Access. It's like the full meal plan, right? You get the full clients for those.
It's based on the old Professional Plus suite. I don't even know if they still sell it, but it's the subscription version of that. The expensive.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. Yes. $12 per user per month. Lets you download the apps onto PCs and Macs, I think up to five, right?
Yeah, I think it is per user.
I think so.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay, so that's what we're talking about when we're talking about this new world order. We're not talking about Office 2016 if you go out and buy it on a non-subscription plan. That's called a perpetual client, right? So you have...
Which is ironic because it's really not that perpetual.
But it's not really perpetual, but so if you buy a single local client and you don't buy it as a subscription, you get right now, you get 10 years of support, 5 years of mainstream support, which means you get feature updates and security updates free from Microsoft for 5 years, then five years of extended support, which means you get only security updates for another 5 years.
So just real quick, to kind of put this in perspective, because I think a lot of people don't quite understand this. If you buy a copy of Office 2016, whatever version, you're tying it to one PC. That's correct. The license. And then it has that support lifecycle that you just mentioned. Yes. Today, it's a little unclear how new features arrive, but I think the simplest way to say it is that you will get them last with that version of Office, that Office 365 subscribers can join, you know, fast ring and slow ring versions of Office Insider, and the normal subscribers can get them. And then eventually they'll kind of filter down to the perpetual customers, the guys who, you know, own Office.
Yeah, correct.
The other thing is just so people understand too, on the Office 365 side of the fence, there are various subscriptions, consumers and businesses. And the business versions, because Office 365 Pro Plus is a business offering, kind of run the gamut between straight up services. Like, in other words, what you're subscribing to is the cloud-based versions of Outlook on the web, calendar, email, and so forth. Office 365 Pro Plus, you're subscribing to just the applications. But most of those offerings are both, right? In other words, you're subscribing to some version of Office 365. I think mine is called Business Premium, maybe. They keep changing the name, but I think that's what it's called. And what that gives me is 5 installs of the Office suite on PCs. One on tablet, multiple mobile devices, but also access to those online services, right? Outlook on the web, OneDrive for Business, Skype for Business, and so forth. So the thing that's unique about Office 365 Pro Plus is that it's literally the subscription-based version of just the suite.
Yes.
Right? That's the... What did you say the cost was? $12 per user per month?
$12 per user per month. Yep.
So I want to say... I'm probably wrong about this, but I think the version of Office 365 I pay for, which includes the cloud stuff, is somewhere between $15 and $18 a month, right? Because it's not just those 5 sets of applications, it's the services as well.
Yep.
Right?
Okay. So that's all. I think so far we're clear and on the same page, as clear as we can be. On this.
So, and by the way, we practiced this for like 17 hours yesterday.
We did. Yesterday we went back and forth on this a lot.
A little confusing.
The reason this blog post kind of went off the rails, in my opinion, was Microsoft worded it very strangely. They made it sound, in the way they worded this, like going forward after the year 2020, you had to have Office 365 Pro Plus or you couldn't connect anymore to the cloud services like Exchange and Skype for Business. That is actually not true.
I Skyped Mary Jo yesterday and I said, does this literally say what you just said? And you said, no. And I said, are you sure? Because if you parse the sentence, it's a little confusing. But
actually,
you have to parse the whole thing.
You do. So what it really said was, if you are subscribing to Office 365 Pro Plus, you're going to get the most up-to-date client and the most up-to-date set of features first. Like, if you're somebody who wants all the latest bells and whistles as soon as Microsoft puts them out there, you want Office 365 Pro Plus.
And by the way, they have new stuff every month. I mean, I don't have it in the notes, but this past month alone, off the top of my head, they released Microsoft To Do. They expanded or they made Office Groups. That are, I don't know what they're really calling that, but let's say Office Groups. Part of Outlook, broadly available, generally available. They released Skype for Windows 10 as a non-preview.
Outlook they Customer brought, Service Manager.
Yep, that was another. So, I mean, this is like 1 month, you know, 4 fairly major releases, right?
Yeah. But
a lot of that stuff, you have to be, all of it actually, you have to be on Office 365. Some of it, you have to be on the Insider program. So pays is the wrong word, but if you want to have the latest stuff, you have to be involved with Office 365.
You do. If you're somebody who doesn't care, Like you just use Word occasionally and Excel like four times a year or whatever. You probably don't care if you have all those bells and whistles. So if you're that person, you are going to be able to continue to connect to Office 365 services after the year 2020. But you're going to have to have, but you're going to have to have a version of Office that is still in mainstream support. So, okay,
and
say you have
change.
Office. What
you just said is the crux of the change for Office perpetual users.
It is. So if you're somebody who has Office 2010 or 2013, you are not going to be able to connect to Office 365 after the year 2020 because of this change. If you have Office 2016, you also are not going to be able to connect to the back-end cloud services because mainstream support ends on the exact day that Microsoft's putting this policy into effect.
Coincidence?
No coincidence. Plan. Plan.
So there's, in other words, what they're doing is tying, let's see if I get this right, tying, well, it was always like this though. They're basically making the subscription versions of Office match the support lifecycle of the standalone versions of Office.
I believe that's a good way to look at that. Yeah.
Yes. And on the flip side, they're tying your ability to access Office 365 services from a non-Office 365 version of Office, a perpetual version, to the support lifecycle as well.
Yes.
So it's not really perpetual if you want to access Office 365.
Right. Here's the thing that blog post never says, which it should have said, but they didn't because I feel like that blog post was trying to scare people to go cloud, right? So
that's absolutely a fact.
So here's what we know. Microsoft is going to come out with another version of Office Perpetual before 2020. We know they are. It's going to be called Office 2018 or Office 2019. Yep. We just don't know when or what it's going to be called, but it's going to be available. So if you are somebody who's like, nope, I don't want a subscription Office, you are going to want to go buy Office 2018 when it's available or 2019, whatever it is, because you will be able to use that to connect to the cloud service.
You got to start doing some math, right? I mean, in other words, in fact, I haven't done the math. And so let's just, I don't know if I can do this off the top of my head, but at least to present the math problem, which is this. If you do want to access things like OneDrive or Skype, or then I'm talking about the business versions here, from your Office Perpetual suite, what that means is you can do that for 5 years now. It's not 5 years from date of purchase. It's five years from the time it was released, right? Literally on October, whatever date, I think it's October 20th or whatever, 2020, on that day, if you have a perpetual version of Office 2016 on the Mac or the PC, you will no longer be able to access those services unless you pay to upgrade to the new version, whatever it's called, Office 2019, 2020, whatever. Your version of Office costs X amount of dollars. It will cost X amount of dollars per year to subscribe to Office 365. You're going to have to do some math here about what makes sense. And that math is actually going to evolve over time because, again, it's not tied to your to the time you purchase it. It's tied to the time you are in the life cycle of this product. They're making it complicated, in other words.
Yes, they are.
To be fair to Microsoft, I think this is necessary, as kind of awful as it is. I also think that there's a possibility that that next perpetual version might be the last one. You know, I think we're getting to the point where maybe, that part doesn't so much matter. But but related to this is that they're doing something very similar in Windows 10, and it answers a really big question that we've had all along, which is, if you keep introducing new versions of Windows 10 at the clip of once or twice a year, now we know it's twice a year, but once or twice a year so far, at what point do you stop supporting the older version? You know, most consumers update along, right? If you're on an Office 365 plan, likewise, you will upgrade along. The things we just described don't apply to you because you will get Office 20, whatever they're calling it, as part of your subscription as long as you keep paying for it. You don't have to worry about that. You just have to worry about paying the bill. But on the Windows side, it's kind of interesting because Windows always has had that same 10-year life cycle like we were describing for Office, 5 years of mainstream, 5 years of extended. new features during the first 5 years, fixes only during the second 5 years. At least that's the promise. It doesn't mean they actually introduce features, but now they literally are introducing features. And so the funny thing is, though, the Windows lifecycle has actually changed maybe a little more dramatically. We know, for example, that they're going to release two versions every year.
Right.
Now, they're only pledging to support new features for you for free for 18 months, which is three releases. Meaning, I'm sorry, I didn't say that exactly right. After 18 months, the version of Windows 10 that is older than 18 months is no longer supported.
So but that's already you the case.
It's already the case. Okay.
Yep.
It's already the case. Really? Okay. I thought it was longer than that.
Oh, okay. I think it's so 18 months. I think because, okay, on May 9th, the very first version of Windows 10 will no longer be supported. So that came out in July 2015.
Yeah. It's almost
so that
years.
Was longer.
Well, yeah, but that's okay. That it's the first version. We can give them a pass on it. But but they are. But you know, in other words, if they had said we're going to support three versions of Windows 10, that could be an arbitrary timeline, right? It could be any time because they release these things on whatever schedule. But now they're releasing them twice a year. We know that they're going to do it in March and they're going to do it in September. And so now we have a very definitive schedule. The version that they just released in March, the creators update, will only be supported through September 2018. After that, in order to be supported in any way, meaning not just new features, but bug fixes and security fixes, which is really the biggest deal here, you actually have to move forward to a newer version of Windows 10. Mm-hmm. Now, I would imagine if you're in a business on an enterprise, you know, like the long-term servicing branch, that what I just said may not actually be the case.
Yeah.
But for normal people, for individuals, that's pretty much as far back as you can go. I sort of like that. In other words, I like the formal declaration of what we're supporting here. It's a little goofy on the Office 365 side because they only talked about Pro Plus, and then they talked about Perpetual, which no one thinks of that thing as perpetual, but whatever. But this announcement, which spanned two blog posts and had all this other gunk in it, there's really some important concepts here that they had never spelled out, to my knowledge.
No.
On either side. And so 18 months, three versions of Windows 10. That's the support matrix. And you remember we had a conversation months ago where I was talking about the old days. And when they released a new version of Windows every 3 years, you look at a 10-year time span. And at any given time, you're pretty much going to have three versions of Windows out in the wild. Mm-hmm. Yep. You know, you had Windows Vista, you had Windows 7, you had Windows 8. Those were the three versions for that little period of time. Mm-hmm. They basically ensured that that's the case going forward as well. Because remember, I said, well, wait a minute. You know, over 10 years, we had three versions of Windows. But now if you shift forward to Windows 8, so we've got 8.1, we get 10.0, we get 15.11, we got anniversary update, we got creators update. All of a sudden, within the span of that 10 years, you're going to have many versions of Windows to support. Right. But now we know that not to be the case, right? So it makes sense. It's the right thing to do. It's probably going to freak some people out.
But if you're here, so two things to add to this. One is the change of supporting Windows 10 feature updates and Office 365 Pro Plus updates to 18 months. That's actually up from 12, according to their blog post.
Okay, so that's an improvement. But,
and if you're an IT pro and you're like, you know what, I don't really care about applying the creators update. I'm going to wait for Redstone 3. Now you can do that more easily because they're supporting you for 18 months. So it kind of gives you this ability not to have to rush to beat the update clock, right?
And actually, and beyond that really, right? So in other words, if any given version of Windows 10 is supported for 18 months, that means you could install the creators update right now. And for 18 months, not install the next three versions, essentially.
Yep. You could defer your updates or postpone them through Windows Update for Business and Group Policy and just not do that.
What if you were an individual, though?
You probably don't
have that capability.
No, because this is all about business, right?
Yeah.
This is just about business we're talking. So, and then here's another interesting thing. Taro Alhonen, who we're friends with on Twitter, said he just found some wording that says, Microsoft won't deliberately prevent you from connecting to the Office 365 services if you aren't running the mainstream client, but the quality of your Office 365 experience will diminish over time. So it's like they're not completely blocking you.
Now, is that something they planned, or is that just because the way it is? You know,
yeah. You're gonna notice that your zero to 60 times are gonna go down a little bit.
Yeah, it's a little like, you know what? We're not gonna totally chop you off, but
you're not gonna like
gonna
it.
Worse.
You're gonna be very unhappy.
Yeah,
that is really funny. It would actually be better if we just cut you off, but we're gonna make your life miserable instead. Yeah.
Well, what are they gonna bring Clippy back? I mean, there's so many things they could do to punish us.
We're gonna.
I see you're trying to use Office 365.
I see you're trying to use an old version of Office. Let me help you with that.
Yeah.
Oh Lord. Microsoft.
So you see why we were saying this, like yesterday we were both on Skype going like, okay, what do you think this means? I don't know. What do you think it means?
Yeah, I mean, I covered it as kind of a news story. Like I should say, it's funny how I actually wrote this in my initial post. It's funny how different people write different things about the same topic, right? So in other words, Microsoft announces this, and my take on it was basically the way Microsoft presented it, which was Microsoft is tying the development cycle of Windows 10 and Office 365 together. Great. A lot of the enthusiast type blogs wrote, hey, we know when RS3 is coming out, right? They just said it's March and September. That means it's coming out in September. You know, and to me, it's like, yeah, right. Okay. I mean, I just don't, it's weird. You know, I'm just not young enough to think of it that way, I guess. I don't know. Like, okay. Yeah, that's true. It's not really super interesting, but okay. But the more you look at it, you know,
Wait a minute. You think young people are more interested? Is that what you said?
Tech enthusiasts.
I'm not young enough.
I'm old and grouchy.
No, and you know what? That was the easiest part of that post to digest in a way, right? It's like, oh, they just gave us a date for Redstone 3. Yay. Okay, now we know it's September because we thought it was November.
What I meant by that was there's all this information there, and it's funny how like a younger guy would typically we'd pick that part. Oh, my God, look at this. Oh, my God.
Less
experienced
technology.
It's a failing of me that I didn't didn't write that as the headline. Like, that's a good point. I mean, it is, we do know that date now. That's absolutely a news story. It's just interesting to me how different it is. But, you know, I go back and look at this thing, and my initial reaction to this was that I just wrote the news story, but then I sort of analyze it, and I look at the world through sort of a Windows lens. I mean, I care more about Windows, I think, than anything else, and including my family and my friends and my house. and I looked at this like they have finally formally spelled out a Windows 10 support site. This was like a missing chunk for me.
Yeah,
and I thought that was a big deal. Mm-hmm. And I thought there was another story there that I thought was literally we're cutting off Office. You know, I thought that was kind of the other big story. And when I finally went to write that, that's when we talked. And I said, please tell, I said, you wrote about this, right? And you pointed to me what you wrote. And you interviewed somebody. You talked to a guy from Microsoft.
Yeah.
As I recall.
Luckily, because I wouldn't have read the blog post correctly if I hadn't interviewed somebody from Office.
Yeah. So you have, you have like the tablet that explains what the thing says. And I was literally cutting little, like single lines, like, okay, so this says this. Right? And she goes, no, it doesn't say that. And I said, well, it does, you know, but it's like, no, that's not what it means.
Yeah.
And this is how we spend our life, Leo. It's
it
sad.
Is.
Well, you got to do something.
We're all going to die eventually. Yeah. You got to fill the time.
Yeah. We all have to do something.
Yep.
But yeah, you know what? That Redstone date is interesting because we didn't know when Redstone 3 was coming. We knew this fall, right? And I kept hearing like November. Like I kept hearing quite late.
I'm sorry. That was my little bit of the thing I wrote up when I said I approached this from the Windows 10 standpoint.
Yeah.
I did look at that date, and what I came away with was something that was tied to the creators update. In other words, if you look at any creators update review, you will probably see something that seems like criticism and is that where someone, anyone, I said it, you know, Peter Bright said it. I think a lot of people said this. This is an awfully minor update for a major update. Right. You know, there's really not a lot of new features going on here. And maybe put a little more correctly, there aren't a lot of new features in here that are going to impact a lot of people in a major way. In other words, some of the big features are things like 3D and the VR infrastructure, which are not going to impact a lot of people. Some of the things are a lot of new features for Microsoft Edge, which, sorry, are not going to impact a lot of people.
Hey, but what about Bash?
Yep. So... Wow.
Hundreds of new bash features.
But I think this is the new schedule. In other words, they said March and September. Well, March just happened. We're already on the schedule, folks. And that release they just came out with was by design, not the mess that the anniversary update was, which I think was part of the problem with the issues they had getting it deployed. That what we've settled on, and by the way, you know, Windows is a mature operating system. This makes tons of sense. We're going to do two updates a year. They're not going to be humongous releases, right? I've sort of described these things as upgrades because they are literally on the computer. They upgrade your computer to a new version of Windows 10. But these are they're feature updates, right? That's what Microsoft is
like
always
called. Like feature packs, right? Yeah, the old feature packs.
It really is closer to that, right? And just understanding that makes it okay in a way, you know?
Yeah.
That the Creators Update in some ways is somewhat disappointing in that it's not a super big bang release. But you know what? It's probably going to deploy easily, you know, reasonably reliably compared to the last one. And maybe this is a more digestible format for updates, frankly.
Right.
So I look at this as a good thing, frankly.
Yeah. I think all in all, it is a good thing. I mean, the one part that I think is going to freak people out when they fully realize it is Office 2016, if you are running that client and it's after the year 2020, you're going to need to move to a new version of Office. If you don't,
And
you're having you're going to have a degraded experience.
You will be degraded by Microsoft.
You will be degraded.
You think it'll be verbal? Like they'll go, oh, you're a terrible person. That prose is the worst. You call that writing? That's typing.
Right. But that one's a little less clear cut. There's a very compelling argument to be made that arbitrarily it is, October of 2019. I just bought my brand spanking new computer and got a copy of Office Perpetual at great expense. And now you're telling me I can't connect to all those services on the back end after 1 year, right? That's going to be a tough conversation.
Maybe OEMs will start bundling Office 365 as a service and not.
They already do, by the way.
But you won't really get perpetual client.
No, you should never get a perpetual client. I've been saying that for years. But I mean, the problem is people want that. You know, people still have this. Some people, I don't know who I'm talking about people, but you know, some people, you know, those people, they want to own the thing, right?
I know.
And you can make all the arguments in the world about multiple PC installs, the ability to. You could actually have Office 365 installed on 10 different computers. Microsoft doesn't actually care up to like it's like 10. And you could move them around easily. You can take them on and off. And there's no worries at all. It works great. You get additional storage, right? And in OneDrive, a terabyte of storage. And you do the math over 5 years, you know, the supported life cycle. You can make this argument. Like this makes tons of sense. And then people still are shaking their head saying, no, I don't care. I want to own this thing. Yeah. I'm only going to use one computer. I don't care. Mm-hmm. Right? Those people are still out there. So they're not going to be happy with this, you know, in some cases. Or I guess, you know, businesses too, right? Since this is ultimately about business, really, right? Mm-hmm. I don't think Microsoft, they haven't said, but hopefully Microsoft doesn't cut people off from the consumer versions.
Right. They haven't said anything about consumer at all. Right.
But I mean, I am.
Okay. I get it now. That's not so bad.
Well,
and consumers would be a little miffed.
They really want you to subscribe. I mean,
maybe it's just a matter of time before they do this.
I know. They haven't said they'll never do it.
Right.
This is a math problem. In other words, if you look at a 5-year block and you say, I'm going to buy for 3 employees in a really small business, 3 standalone copies of Office Perpetual, some version, that costs X amount of dollars. And then I'm going to subscribe to Microsoft's online services only. So in other words, the opposite of Office 365 Pro Plus, whatever it's called, the version where you just get the cloud services, email, calendar, storage, et cetera.
I think Office 365 Business, right? Business Essentials.
That sounds right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Whatever the cost of that is, times 3, times 5 years. Mm-hmm. How does that compare to the cost of just going full-blown Office 365 Professional Premium? I suspect the latter is going to be a lot less expensive. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the argument you have to make.
I think Brad Sams needs to build a calculator calculator.
It's the Office 365. Yeah, it's like, at what point does Office 365 pay for itself?
Yes. I'm volunteering Brad because Brad loves numbers.
And he loves spreadsheets. And he can't wait to do another spreadsheet.
It's hurting my brain just to think about this.
I know.
But I'm almost positive that not only will Office 365 straight up, meaning Office 365 Business Premium, in this scenario, will make, not only will that be cheaper, it's probably going to be way cheaper. Hmm. Way cheaper.
All right.
Let's find out.
Prove me wrong.
So the mobile Windows 10 Creators Update Mobile Edition is starting to roll out. I saw Donna Sakar posted that. Mm-hmm. And how is the desktop edition coming out? Are people getting it now?
Supposedly.
Do you know anybody who's got it?
Yes, we do know people who got it.
Yeah, sure. We got it because we pushed it. But
some people are getting it rolled to them.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Microsoft said, what, today or yesterday, I guess last night, that millions of people have gotten it.
Millions.
They provided a mini kind of two-week update. They didn't really have any hard facts. It was kind of a recitation of what we already know, that it's going out to known good PCs first, and, you know, they're slowly going to push it out after that. AdDuplex, which does that monthly usage data information, which is very useful, this month looked specifically at the Creators Update rollout, and it's a little hard to estimate these things, but they say to them, it seems that it is rolling out at basically the same pace as the previous update. But I actually think that works out to be a faster pace in a way, because this time they're rolling it out more conservatively because of what happened last time. In other words, they're more stringent about which PCs get it right away. Mm-hmm. So this suggests to me that they're seeing great success. AdDuplex also said that that Microsoft's own PCs are getting it first.
Oh, that's funny. You don't mean company. You mean Surface Book and Surface Pro.
Right, because, you know, they're known good configurations. Right. Like, that makes sense.
Better be.
And that within the scheme of Surface, specifically Surface Book and Surface Pro 4, i.e. the most recent products that are sold in volume, are likewise the ones that are getting it the earliest overall.
You know, so you know what's funny about what you just said is all the people who've been tweeting to me saying, I got it, Microsoft pushed it to me. I think maybe one or two had Microsoft hardware.
Let me flip that one on its head, because the people who have come to me and said, I don't have it yet, have almost universally been on a Surface device. You know,
right.
And I think but that makes sense, because if you're on a Microsoft device and you're not getting the Microsoft update, it does make sense that you would notice that and be concerned about it and would wonder why. And that's a great question.
Yeah, because I wish I hadn't done what I did, which is to
in a way, right? Like just to kind of see what happens.
Yeah.
I have not been offered it yet on the HP laptop.
Okay.
I got to start breaking out computers.
Yeah, let's see what
break
you,
them
see,
out.
See what you, yeah.
Because I did what Leo did, which is I installed it on too many computers, and now it's difficult to see.
And have had zero problems, right? I mean,
that's right. Yeah zero problems. Although I did have a
much
blue
better
screen
rollout.
Yesterday.
You had a what?
I did have a blue screen yesterday. I don't see those a lot. But it was my fault. I tried to browse the web, so you know, I didn't want to tax the thing.
And now let's talk about the mobile update, I guess. You had the list, Mary Jo, of the dozen or so phones that are getting it.
Right. So there are only, as Microsoft acknowledged a week or so ago, there are only 13 models of Windows phones that are going to get the RTM version of Windows 10 Creators Update for mobile. There are some of the ones you expect and some that you did not. Like Lumia 550 is on the list, 640, 640 XL, 650, 950, and 950 XL. Those are the only Lumias on the list that are getting this update.
So
then there are...
I'm sorry to interrupt real quick, but the reason I find that list to be kind of interesting is because the 550, 650, and 950 are all the last generation Lumias, right? It makes sense they would get them.
Yes.
The 640/640XL is a previous generation, and it's the only one from the previous gen that is getting it. And that's kind of an interesting choice. I suspect that device, which wasn't a market for kind of a long time, it just got very broad deployment from different mobile carriers for whatever reason. But yeah, it's curious that that's the only one.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, I know. We've heard from a lot of people who are running other Lumias that who've been testing the creator's update and said, yep, you know what? It works great. I don't know why mine isn't on the list. Microsoft says the ones that aren't on the list don't run it well, but I know a lot of testers do not agree with that. So there are a few other phones that are not Lumias on the list. Of course, the HP Elite X3 is on there. There are two Alcatel phones, the Idol S4 and the OneTouch Fierce XL. There's the Lenovo SoftBank 503LV, MCJ Madosima Q 601. I've never even heard of half of these phones. The Vio VPB051 and Trinity Nuance Neo. That's the whole list. That's it. If you're not that list, you're not going to get RTM version of the creator's update for mobile pushed to you. But you can keep running the insider preview of creator's update at your own risk, as Microsoft says.
They just don't want to support you mostly. That's what that means, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
In fact, I've seen people putting it on other phones too, with I think minimal problems.
Mm-hmm.
Yes or no? I mean, you can force it somehow. I don't know the technology.
I think all you have to do is be in the insider program. I think it was going out to a wide range of phones before, and then it kind of surprised people by whittling down the list. Although to be fair, they seem to do this with every release.
And maybe they didn't have good results on some phones, and so they didn't want to support them, et cetera, et cetera.
That's what they said.
Yeah.
Yeah. Whether you believe it or not, that's what they said.
Why wouldn't it? It's not like they're trying to get you to upgrade. I mean,
no, it's related to support. You know, you don't, there's probably such a small number of those people out in the world, especially on Insider, that fully supporting a major new version of the operating system on a small number of devices like that is probably just resource intensive. It probably just doesn't make sense.
Yep. Another thing to know about Creator's Update for mobile is it does not include all of the features that were for PC. It only includes basically a very fairly small subset, I would say, of features that are in
mobile
Windows
Bash.
10. No mobile bash.
I want mobile bash.
I don't think there's even 3D paint, right? Not for phone. I don't think so.
No, I think there's a 3D viewer, maybe. Possibly, but I don't...
There's a few enterprise. You're not using Windows Phone.
Oh, sorry.
Come on. Neither am I. So what am I saying? But there's a few enterprise features, like there's SD card encryption, remote pin resets for Azure Active Directory, a few things like that. But it's definitely not another one that's not a major update. But people who are Windows Phone fan diehards are happy that they did roll this
out. Whoa. First of all, those people are never happy, Mary Jo. And
well, that's true. That's true.
Secondly,
the words diehards kind of tell you everything.
It kind of does.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. When I wrote about this today, I got more tweets saying, I thought Windows Mobile didn't exist anymore. Like, it still exists. So, yeah. It does. Sorry,
guys. Go down to your Verizon store and check.
Where's the Windows Mobile section?
I bet you there. Actually, I wonder. I bet you there's stores with little corners. You'd be surprised. Do you guys ever go into phone stores?
I would be surprised.
Company
stores? I've been in Verizon stores. They've never had good representation
of
Windows
Phone. Verizon, I don't think, even sells a Windows Phone.
No, maybe not.
Yeah.
But, I mean, here in Petaluma, you can find some pretty dust-specked old stuff in the corners of your local phone store.
Right.
I mean, they still sell flip phones, candy bar phones, all sorts of weird.
It's like a nostalgia museum.
It is. But there's a market for it. I mean, not every... Sure. In fact, if you think about it, only nitwits would pay $700 or $800 for a new phone.
I think we know a few of those nitwits.
We are them.
Okay, one little irony alert about, one of many little irony alerts about Windows 10 Mobile. The day that Microsoft rolled it out, it was like around midnight Eastern last night when it rolled out, or a little later. That was 3 years ago to the day that Microsoft bought Nokia. Kind of funny that it was that date.
Wow.
Can you believe that was 3 years ago?
Wow.
I know. A lot has happened.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Kind of amazing.
Yeah.
Well, here comes Windows Cloud, and we'll talk about that in just a second. Mary Jo Foley, Paul Thurrott, we're talking Microsoft at Windows Weekly, our sponsor for this segment of the show. My new host, I love these guys, WordPress.com. I actually did a little post on my blog saying, I'm back, baby, because I've been a WordPress. In fact, I went back and looked. I started using WordPress in 2007, after trying pretty much every platform in the world. And one of the reasons I stopped using WordPress is because I didn't like to have to spend time keeping it up to date. But that's what's so great about WordPress.com. They do the hosting, so... You know, I was self-hosting, so I was like backing up and keeping. They do all that. They back it up. They keep it up to date. And more importantly, they attach you to a big community of WordPress users. It's as much a community as anything else. In fact, as soon as I posted this morning, I got people at WordPress.com commenting, liking it, because it's almost, if you go to WordPress.com, it's almost like a social site. Now, if you're a business, let me pitch you as a business. First of all, by now, it must be coming apparent to you. You need a website. You got to have a website. And some of you have tried, and perhaps you're not completely happy with the situation. It's hard to modify. It doesn't look good. Maybe it doesn't reflect the real inner you or how your business works. Let me tell you, WordPress.com is the place to go. Even if you have no experience at all with websites, they can guide you through the process. Whether you're looking to create a personal blog like mine or a site for your business or both, you're going to make a big impact when you build your site on WordPress.com. It is very modern. It is, in fact, so much so that a number of publications, like big ones, use WordPress as their content management system, their back end. Nobody I've ever heard of, but no, I'm just kidding. A lot of big name sites. Hundreds of themes to get you started. Pick a template. Make it your own. You get built-in search engine optimization. You get built-in social sharing. And as I said, you're part of a community. Not just a community of readers, but a community of people who will help you, support you. The WordPress people have great support 24/7. You know, this is why 27% of all websites in the world run on WordPress. Can you believe that number? It's amazing. 27% of all the websites worldwide run on WordPress, including NBC, CBS, The New York Times, IBM, Fortune, TED, CNN, Time, Quartz, Spotify. Get started today. We've got a great deal for you when you go to WordPress.com/windows. 15% off any new plan purchase. 15% off. WordPress.com/windows. Create your website. Find the membership plan that's right for you. And get 15% off at WordPress.com/windows. I'm so pleased. I've been such a fan for so long. And don't judge me by my site, which is leolaporte.blog. Because it's just, I'm in the process of transferring everything over. I've got, you know, it's nice. WordPress is such a standard. It was very easy for me to get the content over there. But now I want to dress it up and stuff like that. And it's fun playing with it. It's kind of nice. It's good to be back. WordPress.com/windows. Paul Thurrott, Mary Jo Foley. We've got a big event coming up May 2nd. I'm getting up at 6 in the morning Pacific time.
Really?
Yeah, well, I have to. It's 9 a.m. your time, right? You guys will both be at the Windows whatever EDU event.
EDU. Yeah.
And I think we're getting a better picture of what Windows Cloud. Well, first of all, is this the Windows Cloud announcement? I think it is, right?
Yeah.
And I think we're starting to see a lot more about what it might be. In fact, I've even seen specs. Are those credible?
Mm-hmm. This is from Windows Central, and it's marked Microsoft Confidential if it's a real slide. So I'm thinking they're
if that is
probably
your real name.
Real.
My name is Confidential.
Yeah, they got their hands on this slide that says Windows 10 Cloud performance targets, minimum required specifications, benchmarks, and it benchmarks these devices running Windows Redstone 2, which is the creator's update, versus Chromebooks, which is kind of what we thought they would do positioning-wise, at least to some extent, for this event. So anything surprising here on the specs? A quad-core Celeron or better, 4 gigs of RAM, 32 gigs of storage, which I heard from some people like, not so great. Well, but 60.
But that's actually bigger than the minimum requirements for Windows 10.
So, is it really?
Yeah, wow, you can have a 32-bit version of Windows 10. You can have 16 gigs of storage.
Oh yeah, that's right. You can. Jeez. Okay.
Yeah.
So, battery 40 WHR.
Whatever.
Whatever that means.
40. WHR. Watt hour. Yeah.
Watt hour.
I don't know
something?
What R means.
Yeah.
But I mean, 40. Greater 40 than watt, 40. 40 WHR. Watt hours is watt pretty hour. Typical for a laptop. It's a low-end laptop. You know.
Yeah.
That's pretty typical, though. That's good.
I was happy to see this. Pen and touch optional. Because I think, you know, when you add those things to a device, it makes it more expensive and kills the battery. So what they're saying, they're seeing in benchmarks, if this, again, if this slide is correct, is 10 plus hours of battery life using these devices running Windows 10 Cloud, which they will market as all day, right? That's what they'll call that.
I mean,
and it basically is, right?
In a making lemonade sense, if these devices, as expected, will only run store apps and, of course, web apps through Edge, actually, those are two things that are incredibly battery efficient.
That's right.
And, well, you know, watt hours are, you know, how many watts, how many watt hours there are. So if he uses 4 watts an hour, that would be 10 hours at 40 watt hours, right? So you have to kind of figure out what the power consumption as of these things is. But if they're putting, you know, mobile Core M processors in there, or actually, did they mention ARM in this at all?
Nope.
No, ARM's not available yet.
Not
so
ARM, huh?
That can't be part of it yet. I have no doubt.
You're going to see 8 hour, 8 to 10 hour battery life would be probably. For,
I think
40,
you will see ARM at some point.
Yeah,
I do.
Yeah. Well, then they say WoA is coming at the end of the year, so maybe Windows Cloud ARM is at the end of the year.
Yep. Yeah. So the specs look okay. It. I mean, some people are like, "Oh, netbooks." Well. A little better than netbooks.
They're better than netbooks. I think so.
Yeah.
The thing that made netbooks crappy was...
screen size.
Yeah. Mm. And well, the quality of the components was crappy.
Yeah, there were spec requirements. You know, I think you had to stick with 2 gigs of RAM at the time and small amounts of storage. 10.1-inch screen was the biggest it could be. You know, they were purposefully handicapped, you know, to be toys.
I like it that they have require 4 gigs of RAM.
Yeah,
that's a performance target, because you'll see Windows machines with 2 gigs. I mean, it's not impossible.
I know, it's terrible. No, it's terrible, though. It's just, low-end tablets will have 2 gigs of RAM. It's just a terrible experience. Yep.
And you could tell that this is designed to be a Chromebook competitor, because it's got minimal storage.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Right, and that's how they'll call it cloud, right? That's why they'll call it cloud.
And but the storage is supposed to be pretty fast. It's solid state, maybe even eMMC.
Yeah,
I like it that, you know, this is exactly, I would bet if we could find the Chromebook spec, this is pretty almost identical.
Key to this is going to be what it costs to license it. And actually, when you think about the target market, what Microsoft is going to offer schools as far as management goes, right? So you have a lab of kids, they all use a cloud book, and then they leave and the next one comes in. Can a teacher who's not an IT professional flip a switch somewhere virtually and have them all reset, have that happen quickly, you know, have it work reliably? Kids come in, log into their account and go, right? I mean, that stuff has to be there day one. And it's still not going to make any sense, but...
No. And you know what? They introduced Intune for Education earlier this year. I think they're obviously cognizant of the fact they need to have the manageability and security story and ease of use story in place, or it doesn't matter what they have. It just won't even matter.
Right.
So, yeah, I'm encouraged on that one. I think they get that they got to up their game on making it easier to use and easier to manage.
Okay.
But yeah. So we'll see. You know, I mean, this kind of makes it, this, of course, makes you wonder, like, is it, are Windows 10 Cloud books, if they're called Cloud books, only going to be from OEMs, or is Microsoft going to come in with a high-end device?
Well, you don't publish specs if you don't expect other people to make them.
No, I mean, I wonder if Microsoft will make them.
Yeah.
Oh, right. I see. It's the other way around. Yeah. You know OEMs will make them, but will Microsoft?
Right. The OEMs will make them. Yeah.
I predict no.
Yeah. You print it now?
Yeah, because look what Microsoft's making right now. It's the most expensive computers you can get in the Windows space.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yep. They're high-end reference systems.
Yeah.
It's like Google makes one Chromebook, and it's the $1,200 one. And they don't make it anymore.
But they could do that. I, not to keep hammering on this, but this product isn't only for education, and it isn't only to compete with Chromebooks, right? I mean, the expectation is that executives will want this thing as well because it's reliable, it gets awesome battery life, et cetera.
There's too many cheap Windows machines. Really?
Yep.
I don't know. I think they could do it. Equivalent of the Chromebook Pixel, which, you know, Google's not selling anymore, but why not?
Remember, this is the future of Windows, right? I mean, this has always been the dream. I'm not saying it's going to work, but I mean, this is the plan. Mm. You know, Microsoft wants to drop Win32 effectively. They at least want people not to develop for Win32. Yeah. And, you know, there are two tiers to this, and one is UWP straight up apps. And then there are the things that I think of as like hybrid UWP apps, like Centennial apps, project, or Desktop Bridge apps are one. That there's a way to bring the past into the present, right? Contain them, make them safe, make them easy to uninstall and all that kind of stuff, and add some basic UWP features. But progressive web apps are kind of the future, and they're going to integrate into the store as well. They're going to work like native apps. They're going to support live tiles and notifications and all that kind of stuff. And there's the kind of future. I mean, that's not just education. It's not just kids. It's not just Chromebooks. I mean, that's the entire Windows platform. You know, it makes a lot more sense for ARM in such a situation too. You know, I know they're going with the A35 because supposedly it can emulate x86 apps or x86 and run those apps and do so effectively. But let's face it, ideally, on those situations, you're running all the native stuff, and the native stuff is everything I just said. It's not Win32.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
We'll see. I'm not, I mean, listen, I'm the world's biggest skeptic when it comes to this thing. I have my doubts.
Okay. Okay.
May 2nd. We'll find out.
You are right to be skeptical, Leo.
Am I, and now I'm confused because I see this thing that says a Windows 10 watch. What's that?
Yeah, so
they're not coming back with the band's dead.
No,
all right,
band is dead.
We broke up Windows the band. 10.
They broke up the band, but here's the funny part. So this Windows 10 watch that's being built by a Microsoft partner called Trekstor, TrekStor. It runs Windows 10 IoT. We heard one of the reasons that band broke up was because they tried to put Windows 10 IoT in the band and they decided it didn't work out and they couldn't. Oh, so here's an OEM who did it.
Well, but what does it look like though? Is it like a Flintstones watch? Like it's a big rock?
Yes, it does. You know? Yeah. I don't know if you saw the picture of it, but this is not a consumer device at all. This is a business device. Microsoft's saying that it's going to be used in business settings, like industrial factory settings, where people don't want to carry handhelds, right? Instead,
it looks like a weapon.
You'll be able to talk to it.
You could use it like a little
clonk somebody in the head.
Yeah. It looks pretty hefty and ruggedized, I would say.
It's rugged. Yeah. That's it. Rugged.
Yeah.
It's rugged.
But it's going to be Wi-Fi and Bluetooth enabled, run Windows 10 IoT, which means you can run universal Windows platform apps on it. What else did they say? Gorilla Glass 3. They haven't given us pricing or availability on it yet, but still kind of interesting. Somebody's doing a Windows 10 wearable.
I'm not going to get one until they have designer bands.
Okay, good. Good choice.
This doesn't make any sense to me.
Good choice. Yeah, it's a little odd, but again, in some ways it makes sense because where's Microsoft's focus these days? Business market. This is a device very much for like hospitals, industrial factory. It's not meant to compete with the Apple Watch. It's definitely not a consumer device, not a fitness device.
Right. So, although it probably requires some upper arm strength just to lift it.
It's a fitness device in the respect that you can't really wear it.
You're going to look like Popeye, like the arm that you're wearing arms. It on. It's going to be huge.
But in that respect, it is a fitness band. That's pretty funny.
Yeah.
All right. That's a surprising, but you know, maybe it's not so surprising. Maybe that's not such a surprising.
Yeah. It's a little weird.
And because you all love the new Windows calendar so much, I don't know. Does somebody use Windows?
Mary Jo uses it.
Really? As opposed to Google.
Calendar?
Huh?
Oh, no. So this is the, well, actually, you do use that too. This is referring to the applications that are in Windows 10, not to the Microsoft services. But you actually use both, right?
I do. Yeah.
Because you use Notepad. And if you're going to use Notepad, you might as well use.
And she uses real sticky notes.
Yeah. Sticky notes too. Wow. You're all actually in on the Windows ecosystem.
I actually think these apps are a little on the childish side, I guess. I know, kind of immature. Toy side.
You know, it's funny. I had somebody on the radio show call me and said, "I'm required to use Microsoft's Outlook Express, and I just want to know if when the update's coming out."
Yikes.
I said, not since 2002, so I think people still, but you know what was great about Outlook Express? It was simple.
Yeah. No, there was a lot great about it,
people
actually.
People like simple.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If it does for Mary Jo all she needs.
Well, the other way to look at it is it almost doesn't matter which version of whatever app you're talking about. Somebody loves it, right? And so Outlook Express turned into Windows Live Mail, which, you know, became like Windows Mail sort of and was part of Essentials. And there are people who love that,
right?
And it's gone.
Right.
Yeah,
I still miss.
I find it okay. Like
it does
I wouldn't
the job.
Use it. I wouldn't use it to like do a lot of advanced mail management features because those features aren't even in there, right? But yeah, it's all right.
The good news is, if you do use Google Calendar now, you can use it with Windows. Mm-hmm.
So, well, okay, actually, you can today already use Gmail and Google Calendar with Mail and Calendar in Windows 10. Like, that actually works today. So, but what Microsoft has been doing is trying to bring that client up to speed with some of the advanced capabilities that embarrassingly are available in the Android and iOS versions of the app, right? Because remember, this has become like one team now, so they're trying to bring all this stuff together.
They acquired all those capabilities on mobile.
Yeah, yeah. So the big one, of course, is Focused Inbox. And when Microsoft brought that to Windows 10, Mary Jo does not like Focus Inbox.
I hate that feature.
But, it is divisive. It's fair to say. Some people love it. Some people just want to turn it off immediately.
Do you use unfocused inbox? Is that your preference?
Yeah,
that's what it is. No, you know, I don't like Focused Inbox because it automatically sorts mail to things they think
you
want to focus
it.
On.
Yeah.
And
you can spend the rest of your life training it, but it's still going to screw it up.
Right.
It,
I know. I never can get it to. Well, I didn't give it a huge chance. To be honest.
No, so you do use a more powerful tool, and you use filters and things like that, Mary Jo.
I do. Yeah. I use Outlook and Exchange as my regular email.
Anybody who uses email has to, because email is so out of control and unwieldy.
This is kind of a side topic, but actually one of the things I've noticed as time goes forward, I used to be able to say something like, you know, I get like 100 emails a day, you know, like actual emails, not. Mm-hmm. The truth is that I don't anymore.
No, it's almost all junk mail now.
Yes, it's right. And actually, it's just like my home phone. Like, every time it rings, it's some
it's
stupid
like your home
spam
mail, too. Yeah. Yeah.
It's true.
Can you believe how useless cell phones are now? It's all junk calls.
I know.
There are two things you do when you get a new phone. One is you turn off notifications one by one as they happen. And the other one is you block phone numbers again one by one as they come in. It's really strange.
So to the point now that carriers, both AT&T and I think T-Mobile does this now, have call blocking software on the phone.
Yep, yep.
So I'll still get calls, but it says scammer. Well, why did you just not, you know, if you think it's a scammer, just don't ring my phone.
Robocall does the same thing at home. You know, we use that at home. And what happens is it rings once. And it's become like a Chinese water torture thing for us because I would say 9 times out of 10 when the phone rings, it's just.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you using Nomo Robo? Is that what you're using?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a great
service. I like
it.
I wish it didn't have to ring at all, you know.
Right. Well,
it turns out, Fios actually can block calls too. We just.
Right.
Who has the time? We could spend the rest of our lives.
Isn't that telling now that all the phone companies are basically focused on keeping calls from getting through to you?
I know. Yeah.
Well, it's also, but it's arguable that we're not spending the majority of time using phones.
No, that's right.
Make phone calls,
or,
right?
So, or email. We text message, right? We message each other.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, for me, I get a lot of interaction on Twitter. I get comments on my blog. My friends and I will text message each other because we're, you know, 50 right. years old. You know, my daughter uses Snapchat because she's normal.
Right.
Whatever. It doesn't matter. You know, there's all these different solutions for that kind of stuff. But Microsoft introduced some features for the Windows 10 mail and calendar app back in February-ish that were tied to Microsoft's email services. What they're doing is making that stuff available. And one of them is Focused Inbox, Mary Jo's mm-hmm. favorite feature. They're going to make those things available to Gmail and to Google Calendar. The problem is, this is a lot like actually what Focused Inbox was back in the day. Remember when Microsoft bought the company, they were running all of the emails through AWS. And there were business mm-hmm. customers who were like, wait, hold on a second. You can't. You know, we can't route email through a different service. And so they had, you know, they provided a way to turn it off. And well, as it turns out, they're going to have to still basically do this. Of course, Microsoft's not using AWS. But what this means is your Gmail and your calendar items will have to go through the Microsoft cloud. And that's literally the way they're describing it. So that stuff can work in mail and calendar. That's the asterisk. It's kind of a strange deal. In other words, on the Microsoft side, if you're using Outlook.com or Office 365, that functionality works natively, but it works natively because Microsoft's using its own cloud services in the back end. You don't really think about it, but you know they're interacting with whatever on the back end. Mm. For this stuff to work on Google, you'll have to go through Microsoft's cloud services. I think a lot of individuals will be okay with that, frankly, but obviously it's not a business tool per se, but it makes it a non-starter for a lot of businesses.
Yeah, when I read about it, I'm like, who would want this?
A damned if you do, damned if you don't thing, right? So a lot of people do use those Google services, Gmail, whatever. Sure. A lot of people, those same people have Windows PCs, and they probably have been asking Microsoft for many months now, hey, when are you going to do this? And you're right. The truth is, I look at this and I think, why would anyone do this? I just use web clients. I don't really care about this stuff. But yeah, people are asking for it.
Mm-hmm.
They're demanding it, Paul. People everywhere are demanding Google integration.
Well, there's a rich history, and it's not a good one, of Google services on Microsoft email.
Yeah.
You know, remember the Windows Phone fiasco and the YouTube app, which is semi-related to this. I mean, there's a lot of animosity.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Did Google have to cooperate with them to do this?
No, they have an API.
No, that's the point of pushing it through Microsoft's cloud services. In other words, we're going to insert an intermediary into the chain. And so instead of right now, today, you can do it, right? In other words, Google uses whatever protocols. You can connect to the services from the apps. They work. Your calendar will appear in calendar. Your email will appear in mail. But to do these advanced features like Focused Inbox, because, you know, it's like cloud-side filtering, essentially, right?
Right.
They have to insert a cloud server. I was just, I don't know what that was. That was like I'm giving a proctology exam.
For those of you listening at home.
Yeah. Right.
You can
Paul
imagine.
Paul just put on rubber gloves for some reason.
What is that dollop of Vaseline for, Paul?
You might want to get your affairs in order. You know, they have to insert their service between the two, so.
Yeah, got it. Thanks for the visual.
Yeah. Sometimes I do things like I point at stuff as if it means anything to you. It's like, you know, the guy who lives over there, you know, and I point back there.
Behind us over here.
You know that
guy? That guy. I know that guy. Tell you what I'd like to do right now, Mr. Thurrott. Mm-hmm. If you have no more to talk about, we do have, by the way, a little celebratory cartoon in the show notes because there is no Xbox news. And Paul says it's your housewarming present, Mary Jo.
It's a housewarming present.
It's the seal of approval. Good job. Yep. What is this, Slack? What are you doing?
That's how Mary Jo does emojis.
It is.
By the way, tomorrow's Microsoft's earnings, right?
Yep.
Twitter surprised everybody. They beat the street by a substantial amount. But the street thought they'd have 1 cent per share earnings. They had 11 cents per share earnings.
Wow.
What do you think? Microsoft going to be a big quarter?
Microsoft has been very consistent financially. I think the bigger issue is going to be what they say.
Like, right? And what sales they don't say.
Yeah, so you know, Surface will be up. You know, if Surface did well, it will. They'll say some percentage, but they'll never say unit sales. Yeah. You know, that kind of thing. What they say about Windows is going to be very interesting. Are we going to get a new number for Windows 10? We haven't had a number since what, October?
I know.
400 million. So is it 500 million now? Is it 450? You know, people are going to start doing math again, right? That's always dangerous.
Mm-hmm. Do math.
Please don't. Yeah, then cloud run rate. Cloud run rate is your drinking game word.
You could make a matrix of Microsoft's products and services versus each of their quarterly reports, and you could kind of check off when they mentioned each one. And what you would find is that they never mentioned the same ones twice in a row. So it makes it impossible to compare, you know, not to mention the fact that they don't use hard numbers. They'll say things like Surface sales were up 35% in the quarter over a year ago quarter. Great. What were they a year ago? Oh, we never said. That quarter, they were up 10% year over year. So we never really find out, you know.
Right. So what numbers will you, or what words will you be looking for? I mean,
in my drinking game Microsoft Bingo card.
Yes.
The center of the board this year will always be transformation, right?
No, Microsoft is going to
know. No more.
What?
We're done.
Is it too much?
No, they say it all the time. I hate
too
that
easy.
Word.
Too easy. Well, no, but that's my point. In other words, that's the gimme. They're
digital
gonna say this
transformation story. Will be said many times.
Many times.
No, but also cloud run rate, right? Because they keep talking about that. You know, we're progressing towards our projected $20 billion cloud run rate, and here's where we are now. You'll always hear that one. What you will not hear is the words Windows Phone. But that's not surprising.
That's true. I think it must have been January back. I guess that would have been the last one. You know, one of the surprises from that, as I recall, was that Surface sales were actually better than expected. And that was interesting at the time because they hadn't updated those products in over a year. And so here we are literally 1 year later, and those same devices are actually selling really well, comparatively speaking. It wouldn't surprise me if that wasn't the case again, year over year.
Really? Yeah.
Only because I think a year ago they were having some issues, you know.
You remember
this was the time of Surface Gate and the reliability stuff. Right. And I think that would be an interesting sign. And it might hint at why maybe they haven't revved those things very quickly, right? If these things are going along strong, like why bother?
I mean, they did introduce Surface Studio in the quarter, but I don't think that would really add hugely to the numbers.
Yeah. No. No, in fact, in that ad duplex Surface uptick data on Creative Update, it didn't even rate. It wasn't even in there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Office 365, we might get a new number on seats, right? Sometimes we get a number on that, and sometimes we don't.
Sometimes we only get one of the consumer or business.
Right.
You know, we'll see how that goes.
Yeah.
But you got to listen to the call, too, because sometimes, you know, in the conference call, they provide a little more, I believe the term we use is color in the industry.
Yes. Yes.
Sometimes eat the bar, and sometimes the bar eat you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, tomorrow will be interesting regardless. I think it's going to be Microsoft. The one thing they've always been able to do is provide very consistent financial results. It's just a question of where the money's coming from.
Mm-hmm.
I suspect Sicily.
Good guess.
All right. Well, let's take a little break. Then it's the back of the book for you two. Your future home. Our show today brought to you by Rocket Mortgage. Boy, if you are looking for a home loan or to refi, I got a strong recommendation for you. Don't go to the people we got ours from. Big name, 3 years ago, big name bank. They're actually, I think, the largest lender in the country. And we thought, oh, how long could this take? And it took them more than a month. And the worst part was they kept coming back to us and saying, can you get us? Literally 2 or 3 weeks into the process, we had a trip plan. We went on a cruise. We're still faxing stuff from the cruise ship. Anyway, don't have to do that anymore because now there's Rocket Mortgage. And it comes from the number two lender in the country right after those guys, Quicken Loans. And they're number two for a reason, growing. And I'm sure we'll eclipse this these other guys any minute now because they're good. They're smart. They're trustworthy. And they're high tech. They really take advantage of modern technology. And I'll give you an example. They have a loan product called Rocket Mortgage just for us geeks. It's entirely online. No going to the bank, no going through paperwork, no fax machines involved, no bankers' boxes full of documents, no trying to find the bank statements in the attic. Everything submitted electronically, and it takes you just a few minutes. You can even configure it because, you know, computers, friction-free, online, modern. You can configure the rate of the loan, the time frame of the loan payback, all that stuff. Get it just right, get the loan that's right for you, and get approved not in a month or two or even weeks or days, but in minutes. You can do it at an open house. You can go to an open house and say, yeah, well, hey, we really like this house. Let's buy this house. And then go to Rocket Mortgage and get the loan and show the realtor 2 minutes later, look, see, we're approved. Go to quickenloans.com/windows. Don't waste time searching through stacks of paperwork. Don't skip the bank. Skip the waiting. quickenloans.com/windows. For Rocket Mortgage, they're an equal housing lender, of course. Available in all, licensed in all 50 states. And MLSConsumerAccess.org, number 3030. You may be not buying a house today, but maybe, you know, this weekend, you're thinking, let's go look at the open houses, like to see what the neighbor's house looks like. And then you say, hey, this is pretty nice. We could move in here. And then you'll be glad you remembered this. quickenloans.com/windows for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online. Brad Sams did it. That's how he got his house. He was telling us on Windows Weekly. And he said, it's so great. You do it all online. And then you still, I mean, you know, banks being what they are, you still have to sign something at the end. But they come to you. A notary comes to you with the documents, and you sign it, and they take it away. It's so easy. I didn't know that part. Brad told us about it. quickenloans.com/windows. It is Windows Weekly. It is, they are Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley from Thurrott.com and all about Microsoft.com, respectively. Let us kick things off in the back of the book with Paul Thurrott and his tip of the week.
By the way, just random aside, you know, in the Microsoft world, we often talk about billion-dollar businesses.
Yeah.
In the online world. Yeah, so in the online world, it's billion users, right? And I'm sure you saw the news say Instagram has 700 million users. But I just saw a headline from the Motley Fool that said that it will become soon Facebook's fourth billion user business.
Wow.
So Facebook, Messenger, and WhatsApp all have a billion users already. Wow.
Interesting. And Instagram is growing super fast, 100 million new users in the last quarter. So,
you must know the guy from the New York Times, Farhad Manjoo.
Yeah.
He wrote an article today about how it has sort of become the new Facebook. And it's interesting because his experience with it absolutely mirrors mine. In fact, it happened at exactly the same time. And it is interesting how that's, it's become Facebook or Instagram's become kind of essential.
Well, there's some question about why they become so big, and partly, of course, is because they've chased Snapchat by copying features.
But, you know, for me, though, well, but by the way, absolutely. So, you know, the guy from Instagram said, so let me get this straight. The Model T has come out, and I'm car maker number two, and you're going to complain because I'm making a car? I mean, you know.
I thought that was kind of an interesting
comment. That's
I mean, he's directly copying them. But also, and I just saw an article about it where the marketing budget for this is huge. Facebook understands. Yeah. I think you said it really interestingly that this is the new Facebook, that the young people don't want Facebook. Yes. Snapchat.
I don't want Facebook. Right. And the one difference between me and the guy from New York Times is he said, I like Instagram better because everyone I know is on Instagram. And actually, that's not true for me. Everyone I know is on Facebook. Right. But the problem with Facebook is that it has become kind of a hell stew of political baloney, those colored text things that I can't stand.
I don't understand why people waste their time with that.
I hate it. And the thing I'm not, you know, Facebook or Instagram's getting better. I don't think it's a great way to share photos, ironically, but it is about photos.
You
and
do
actually
some
that's
great
the thing.
Stuff. You are an Instagram master. You live in the throwback Thursday.
You are.
Yeah. Yep. That's going to end in July, by the way, because I've been doing the calendar thing. So eventually I'm going to catch up to myself where I will lap myself and then I'll be done doing that.
I enjoy it.
Well,
I mean, I really enjoy it.
That to me, that's the stuff I actually care about.
Yeah.
So, Instagram to me is.
Why do you put those there? I'm just curious. Is it for your friends? Is it to save them?
Yes. Okay. I mean, well, in other words, I have...
So you have friends on Instagram.
Yes. I mean, and Instagram is also kind of publicly available, right? So
it's anybody could... It's public sharing.
Yeah, anybody could go look at this stuff. Right. So it's not going to be as inclusive as some of the stuff I might put on Facebook. But I've certainly posted a lot less to Facebook because of Instagram. And I find that my personal focus, which is on photography, is better satisfied by Instagram than it is by Facebook.
Right.
Also, I actually follow people on Instagram. I find myself just wanting to cut everyone off on Facebook. I am so frustrated by, and these are people I know, which is what kind of stinks, right? So many people, I've had to hide so many people on Facebook because I just can't take it anymore. Mm-hmm. Whereas on Instagram, I find myself following things that I think are interesting. I believe it's a woman who lives in Paris who posts the most beautiful pictures of Paris several times a day. And they're new to that day. I think she walks around with a camera and takes photos or whatever. That's how I think. That's how I imagine it. I don't know. But the photos are amazing. And I just find that to be more valuable than what someone I'm vaguely a relative with thinks about politics or text on a pink screen with yellow letters or what. I don't know. Anyway, sorry, that has nothing to do with a tip or a pick. I just thought it was kind of... sorry. So tip of the week is, I don't actually have one of these, but you might have seen that Samsung recently launched a new Galaxy Book laptop, not a phone, and it is running Windows 10, and it looks a lot like the Surface Pro 4, except it has all modern components, Kaby-like processor, USB charging, and so forth, and it costs less than Surface Pro, and it comes with the pen and the type cover already. So if you're kind of tired of waiting for Microsoft to update Surface Pro, you might want to actually take a look at this thing. It looks really interesting. They even have a smaller version. So if you want like a 10 point something inch screen and then there's a 12 inch screen. The bigger one basically matches the Surface Pro, but it's cheaper and it's got more modern specs. So something to look at. It's called the Galaxy Book 2-in-1. And then the app pick of the week, this is going to seem like a strange pick, but I just wrote about it for the book and I'm lazy, is the movies and TV app for Windows 10. I know a lot of people would kind of look at this app and think, why would I ever want to use this? I'm never going to buy movies from Microsoft and I don't care about this kind of thing. But actually, there are two really good, there are two primary reasons. One is it is a modern UWP app. And so if you're just going to play videos of any kind, even local videos, this is actually the most efficient way to do it. And so instead of using something like VLC, which is an okay app, but it doesn't scale very well, high DPI, et cetera, gets really bad battery life. This is a much better app for that. It works with external subtitles. It does all the stuff you would expect. The other reason is if you're out in the world with a Surface device or whatever laptop or Windows device you might have, you might want to rent movies. And by the way, rentals are temporary. Who cares? You can get them from anywhere. Might as well do it through the app that's going to give you the best battery life on the go anyway. Rent them through Microsoft, right? I mean, if you had to do this through iTunes on a PC, that'd be the worst possible battery life experience. It's just a rental. Go through movies and TV. They did add some new features in the Creators Update, which I think are kind of cool. They have like the MIDI mode thing. And there's also like free content in there, movie trailers, you know, not too exciting. But there's a 360-degree video part of the store. They're all free. You can just download these kind of GoPro type videos. But they're neat because if you have a touchscreen, especially, you can kind of swirl around. So the guy's skiing down the mountain, you can actually do like a 360-degree view as you go. So it's all there. So it's free and it's part of Windows 10. And, it really did get kind of a nice update in the Creators Update. So if you haven't looked at it in a while, check it out because it's gotten a lot better.
Excelente. Mary Jo Foley, look at you and your enterprise pick of the week.
Look at me.
Look at you in your new apartment with a TV set.
What else could happen? Only an Xbox would be the craziest thing in here, but it's not happening. My enterprise pick has to do with Dynamics 365 and LinkedIn. If you remember last year, when Microsoft completed its acquisition of LinkedIn, they gave us a list of things that were like their first priorities. And one of them was integrating Dynamics 365 with LinkedIn. Well, here it comes. It's coming in July, the first piece. Microsoft announced this week that they are going to take Dynamics 365 for Sales and LinkedIn's product called Sales Navigator, bundle them together into a what would you call it? A thing.
A thing.
A thing, yep.
That's a good name for thing, it, yeah.
That's going to cost $135 per user per month and is aimed at sales professionals, and they're going to start selling it. So this is the first of the many integration points between these two things. So Dynamics 365 is what Microsoft has for CRM and ERP. LinkedIn also has some things in that space too. And this is going to be how they kick things off on that front. They also announced this week, if you're somebody who cares about Dynamics 365, a new app called Dynamics 365 for Talent. So we had heard they were going to get into the human capital management field at Microsoft, and it sounds like they're taking some of the LinkedIn assets from LinkedIn Recruiter and integrating them with Office 365 and Dynamics 365 and LinkedIn profiles and creating this new app called Dynamics 365 for Talent, also available in July. The July date's significant because that's when Microsoft's big partner show is, and I think we're going to hear even more about LinkedIn and Dynamics there. So that's my enterprise pick.
And your code name, and by the way, before you tell us, I should let you know I haven't eaten anything since last night.
Uh-oh.
Are you doing an intermittent fast?
I am Mr. IF, intermittent fast.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Wow.
I've been, okay. You know, I know, Paul, you know, you're all over the diet fads, and...
Wow. Leo, let me rephrase that in a way that makes me seem like less of an idiot.
No.
I am all over the diet science.
The latest research.
Yes.
Yeah, and I've been reading a lot of Jason Fung's stuff, and he's got a new one called the Obesity Code. But
The intermittent fast guru.
He's the guru of this.
That's right.
And it's been working great for me. I do 42-hour fasts, which means three times a week.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Yeah. I've not done that. I've been intending to do something like that. I just don't eat breakfast every day.
That's a fast. That's lengthening your overnight fast. Paul and I are, you know, the ketosis brothers.
We're men of a certain age.
And a certain girth. Yeah. Anyway, so I know your code name is going to be painful for me, so I'm just going to put my fingers in my ears.
I know. It's going to be especially painful because it's not one code name, but it's a whole bunch of code names around food. Sorry. Our friend the Walking Cat found these. There's a whole bunch of new Microsoft code names that have to do with food. There's soup, breakfast, dinner, tapas, and sandwich.
Love sandwiches.
Amazing.
Sandwich. And all of these have to do, it seems, with Microsoft bringing its Office apps, the full versions of them, to the store using the Centennial Bridge. So he's kind of figured out what some of them might be. Like he thinks soup is Excel. I don't know how he's figuring this out, but he's figuring out which ones are which, and it sounds like we're going to hear pretty soon, maybe at Build or maybe even next week at the cloud thing, who knows, about Microsoft bringing these apps to the store.
And
all the code names are food, which is or food related. So very interesting theme they've got going in Office.
Well, as long as we got a theme going, maybe we should do some beer.
Okay.
A frothy beverage.
A frothy beverage, yes. I have never had a beer from Upland.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I've never had a beer from Upland Brewing before. I had heard of them, but I didn't really
Apparently,
know them.
No one has, because this right. review is very
stark.
Stark. There's no picture. It's got a question mark.
Yeah.
No score.
Well, I
not after today.
Not after today, guys. If you have not heard of Upland Brewing, they're in Bloomington, Indiana, and they are making some really great beers. I got to have one recently called Iridescent. And think about it. It's a perfect spring beer. It's an apricot ginger sour.
Ooh, that sounds good.
It was delicious. Like, not too sour. It almost was like candied ginger and apricot. And I could have just drank that all day. It was very light, like a 6%, and very tasty. And for people who are a little hesitant on sours, I would say this would be a really good introductory sour, because not too sour, and you get a lot of that really good ginger flavor too. So it's called Iridescent, if you ever get to see it around.
It is the unicorn of beers.
Yep.
Iridescent. All right, you guys have some events coming up we probably should talk about here.
We should. We should just run through our calendar for you guys. So next week, May 1, if you're in New York City, it's a Monday, come to Rattle and Hum East. We're going to be there. A lot of your favorite and less favorite Microsoft bloggers will be there. Yeah, we'll be there. Paul will be there. Brad
and watch me be accosted by the help.
Yeah,
that's really I like the wait persons at.
Oh no, I did too. I did.
They're spunky.
They are, and they know Paul, and they give him a love.
Yeah,
they can spot a mark a mile away. Yeah.
Oh, hey, the rat.
Here he is again.
Here's the rat.
Yeah, but we're gonna be there at least 5 to 8. That night at Rattle and Hum East. You don't have to RSVP. Just come by and we'll be there. Awesome. And you can have a beer with us. Yep. May 11th.
That's May Day. May Day.
That's May Day. Right. Yeah. You're right. May 11th. Somewhere in downtown Seattle, we'll know the destination soon. We're going to have our Build 2017 meetup. It's a Thursday night. Colleen from Twit is working on this for us right now.
Really?
Yeah.
What do you mean? Oh, our Colleen.
She's helping us. You're Colleen.
Yeah, Colleen Goldstein. All right. Yeah, good. She's great, she's isn't she? Don't you love her?
Yes. Yeah. She's really good at finding places and doing the research. And
she's a heck of a producer. Yeah.
Huge help.
Yeah. Yep. Good.
So she's finding us a place. So we'll tweet it and announce it as soon as we know for sure. But it's going to be Thursday night at Build, which is May 11th. So save some time and come meet us at Build.
Nice.
Yep.
Last one is, Paul and I are going to be, we mentioned earlier in the show, in Haarlem in the Netherlands, June 19th to 22nd.
That's north of 120th Street, right?
not that
Haarlem.
Oh, okay. I am so jealous. It feels like you just got back from Haarlem.
It does, kind of. I know.
It's such a
cool city.
I can't wait to be there in nice weather.
It's got great beer and coffee. It's the perfect combination.
It does. So Paul's company, is doing a show called Office 365 Engage in Haarlem, and that's why we're going there. We're going to do Windows Weekly Live.
Let me guess who suggested the site. Paul's saying, is there any way we could do events in the Netherlands?
Maybe do 2 a year.
Yeah.
Like the Windows 10 release schedule.
I'm so jealous.
Yeah. So if you're thinking about an Office 365 show, I've gotten a little sneak peek at some of the sessions for this thing, and it's going to be pretty good. It's going to be not your usual Office 365 show. So I'd say go to.
It's in a cool place.
It is. Cool place, cool people. You can drink beer with us, whether that's an incentive or not. I'm not sure. But
what's the name of that? Do you remember the name of the brewery that began with a J?
Jopen.
It's in the old church.
Jopen.
Yep. I think so.
We'll be there.
We will be there.
Paul will be staying there. That's the
difference. I got a job with the monks.
Yeah, so if you haven't registered and you would be able to come in mid-June, we would love to have you come because we'll be there.
We're going to be doing the show live from the place.
We will.
And having a meetup there. And this way everyone, we went to Wartel last time. It was awesome. But, of course, Wartel is sort of near, it's right outside of Amsterdam. And so it was a little tough for people from the show to get back and forth. And so this time we're going to stay at the show, so everyone who's there can just be there, if they want
to. I hope Wartel will come out and bring some more.
I still want to see those guys. I mean, they were awesome. Yeah.
They were.
Obviously. They were really good. And they were great to us. But, we're going to do it this time from the location.
Good.
Nice.
Fantastic.
Also, if you don't mind a quick follow-up, there was a conversation on Twitter in the wake of our discussion of Focused Inbox. And most people disagree with Mary Jo. They believe it's an awesome feature. But actually, the real discussion was around the Acompli's use of AWS, and that Microsoft, I think at last year's Ignite, said that they were going to change it over to a Microsoft cloud.
Oh, that's interesting.
They still apparently have not done so. So that actually still goes through AWS today, even though Microsoft owns it.
Oh, wow. I thought they had done that already. No,
right? I did too, and I'm being told by people I trust, Taro. Al Honan, for example, I think who started this, that actually they have not made that switch. I thought they had.
Oh, well.
Maybe what we're thinking of is that they announced they were going to do it.
Yeah, maybe.
Then they never did.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. That is kind of surprising.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah. It's like when you find out that Hotmail is still running on free BSD.
Yeah, remember that?
Who knew?
Right.
I know.
No wonder it still works.
Yeah, no wonder it's so reliable. Yeah. Scaling is everything. And, you know, just because, I mean, that's a tough challenge, you know. And
sure.
Big services like that, that's a tough thing to do.
I wonder if it uses some kind of back-end service that, for whatever reason, is particularly efficient on AWS.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's probably written in, like, Erlang. And so,
or in Delphi, maybe. You never know.
I don't think so.
Just saying, it's possible.
Yeah.
Paul Thurrott, you'll find him at thurrogood.com. That's his website. He also publishes at leanpub.com. And that's all the books, including the Field Guide, the new Field Guide series, which is great. Field Guide to Windows 10 is a must-have. Beautiful illustrations. Do you still have the poster deal, too, if people wanted to get the posters? I love those posters.
Yeah, I do, too. Martin's posters are amazing.
It's really good.
I spent like 6 months writing a book, and he whips out this poster that's
got everything in the poster.
Nicer than, it's like.
I've been meaning to get, I got to get mine framed. I'm running out of wall space. also, Mary Jo Foley, she's at allaboutmicrosoft.com, the ZDNet blog. And together they join us every Wednesday about 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1800 UTC, to talk about Microsoft in depth. In depth. I hope you will, too. You can be in our chat room and chat along with them, or watch on demand, twit.tv/ww, or get it wherever, you know, you get your podcasts and subscribe so you don't miss an episode. It's really nice when, you know, you're going somewhere and you look on your phone, you go, oh, I have something to listen to. You got Windows Weekly automatically. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next time on Windows Weekly. Bye-bye.